Hi friends, welcome to my channel. Please like, share, comment and subscribe my channel. Now I am starting in applied thermodynamics of fifth semester. I am starting the third unit is steam condensers and steam nozzles. Steam condensers and steam nozzles. Now, here there are two different things used in steam power plants. Steam condensers and steam nozzles, they are in one unit. In this you will get only theory. In steam condensers we get only theory. In steam nozzles you can get both theory as well as numericals can also be asked. So first let us take up steam condensers. Now again, steam condensers are closed vessels kept at a constant pressure below atmospheric pressure, that is vacuum pressure. And what happens is the steam is discharged after its expansion in a turbine or any prime mover. It will be discharged into these steam condensers, and the steam condenser, the purpose of the steam condenser is to cool the steam. They cool the steam and again convert it into water. When steam is cooled, it becomes water. In steam plants, there are two types of plants. One are called condensing types of plant and the other is non-condensing type. Condensing type plant means there are condensers are used in that. Non-condensing means there is no condenser used in it. Now, see, we have a boiler to which water is fed from the, this is called feed water. So water is fed into the boiler. It converts it into steam. That steam comes into a prime mover, where it is the prime, in the prime mover it loses its heat. Its pressure becomes lesser. It expands. It does work, and then it is that steam. If you are not using a condenser, this has to be left to the atmosphere. If you leave it to atmosphere, then it is a non-condensing plant. If it is a condensing type plant, what will happen is this steam from the prime mover is passed into a condenser. This comes into a condenser where it is cooled, and then it comes to the hot well, and then it is recirculated into the boiler, and it will be a closed cycle like this. Otherwise it will be an open cycle if this condenser is not there. Now if you have a condenser, it is costlier. You have to have a condenser, you have to run it, you have to have cooling towers, etc., required for the condensing plant, and it becomes costly. When it becomes costly, there should be some advantages in using this. If you use a condenser, what are the advantages? Now the discharge pressure, if there is no condenser, if you are discharging it to the atmosphere directly, then the pressure at which we discharge the steam should be greater than the atmospheric pressure. Say 1.013 is the atmospheric pressure. It should be 1.5 bar, 2 bar, 1.6 bar, 1.8 bar, something like that, slightly above atmospheric pressure. Now that means we are not expanding it to a greater extent, and we are not taking all the advantage of the heat that is present in the steam to the fullest possible extent. Now because this is almost at zero pressure, zero bar pressure, absolute pressure, almost very close to zero, you can discharge the steam into this at a very low pressure. That means you can get more work here, and then this same water is circulated. Now that is one of the advantage. The overall efficiency of the plant will increase, then this boiler will not get corroded once the same water is being used here. So the corrosion will be less, and there will be no chill necessity to have a water treatment plant, feed water treatment plant. All that will be reduced. Once you feed water into this, that water, same water will be getting circulated. So these are some of the advantages of using steam condensers. So you have to know what are the advantages of using steam condensers. Then how they are classified? They are classified mainly into two types. They are, one is surface condenser and the other is jet condenser. These are the two types. One is surface condenser and the other one is jet condenser. You must know the advantages and disadvantages, comparison between surface condenser and jet condenser. The basic difference between the two is, here it's a vessel maintained at vacuum pressure. Now steam is discharged into this from the through pipes. Steam, after it has come out of this thing, steam will be this thing. From here, water, cooling water will be fed. Now this water, cooling water and steam, they come in direct contact with each other. Then the condenser is called as the surface condenser. Here it will not be like that. Here what happens is, this steam which is coming out from this thing will be passing through the pipes. It will come like this, through a number of pipes like this, and the water will be fed here like this, cooling water. They don't come in direct contact. This water that you are taking here doesn't mix with cooling water, so it is advantageous. Then in the sense, this water remains pure and it can be recycled into the boiler, whereas here recycling is not possible. This is bigger in size, this is smaller in size. So these are some of the major comparisons that are there. And then the advantages and disadvantages, they can also ask you to explain any one of them with the help of a neat sketch. In this jet condensers, there are different types, further classification is there. So one of them, they will ask you to write with the help of sketch, explain it, the working of that. No numerical will be asked from condensers. You don't get numericals here. But you get numerical in nozzles. Next, we'll take up steam nozzles. Now, what is a steam nozzle? We have to tell first. Now, steam nozzle is defined as, a passage of varying cross section means its area keeps on changing from one place to another place. If it is a passage of uniform section, that is same area is there at every place, then you call that as a pipe. That passage is called as a pipe. Here it is of varying cross section, that means it will be having different areas at different places. So it can be like this. If it is like this, it is said, if it is passing, the steam is passing, the area is gradually reducing from entrance to exit, then you call this as a convergent nozzle. It can be reversed also. The steam can pass this way also, or you can have a nozzle like this also. Here the area of cross section is gradually increasing from entrance to exit, then you call that as a divergent nozzle. It may be a combination of these two, that is, it will be like this. First, the area of nozzle decreases, it is called the convergent part, and this is called as the divergent part. Then it is called a convergent divergent nozzle. So there are three types of nozzles here. Convergent, divergent nozzle. It's a combination of both convergent and divergent nozzle. Right. So there are three types. These are the three types of nozzles, 1, 2, 3. Now what happens when steam passes through the nozzles? When steam passes through a nozzle, it loses its pressure. That is, the exit pressure, the pressure with which the steam comes out, whatever may be the shape of the nozzle, it may be this way or this, the exit pressure will be always less than the inlet pressure. So it is, the steam expands whenever it passes through a nozzle. We say it expands, that means its pressure decreases, its enthalpy drops, that means it loses heat. The heat at entrance in all the nozzles will be greater than the heat at the exit. So when it loses pressure, when it loses heat, what does it gain? It gains velocity. So it is nothing but a device where the heat energy of the steam, heat energy present in the steam, is converted into kinetic energy or velocity energy. It comes out, the steam comes out with greater velocity at the exit. Here it enters the nozzle at a very negligible velocity, very very small velocity, and it comes out of the nozzle with greater velocity. So you can also say it is a device which converts heat energy of steam into kinetic energy or velocity energy. And these are the three types of nozzles that are there. In all the three types, this is what happens. And the expansion of steam through a nozzle is considered to be adiabatic or isentropic. Means, adiabatic means no heat is transferred. Adiabatic process is defined as a process in which no heat is either absorbed nor rejected. That means total heat in the steam remains the same. So then there is no increase or decrease in entropy. So it is, entropy is constant. That's why it is called as isentropic process. Now you know Mollier chart. I think you have heard this name. Mollier chart is a graph between enthalpy and entropy of steam. This chart is called as the Mollier chart. It will be there in your steam table. It is there at the end. This chart is there. This chart is called as the Mollier chart. This chart we call as Mollier chart. Now, this adiabatic process is represented on the Mollier chart by a vertical line. Adiabatic process is always represented by a vertical line because in this process entropy or S is constant. It is also called as HS diagram or Mollier diagram. So it is represented by a vertical line. This you must know. This theory you must know. Then these steam nozzles are used in steam turbines and steam injectors. Steam injector is a accessory of a steam boiler. There also we use nozzles. We use them in turbines also. So we should know it. Now here the problem numerical will be asked. One numerical will come where what we have to find out is what is the velocity, exit velocity, but what velocity. Generally the problem will be what is the exit velocity. That is, with what velocity the steam is discharged from the nozzle and or the area of cross section of the nozzle at exit. Now these are the commonly asked things which can be asked in a nozzle. So there will be a numerical on this. This much theory you must know in nozzles. Now coming to the numericals in steam nozzles, there are two types of problems that can be asked. One is on any nozzle. It need not be any type of nozzle. It may be convergent, divergent, or convergent and divergent. Any type of nozzle may be there. What we have to find out is find the exit velocity, that is with what velocity it comes out of the nozzle, and discharge given the area at exit, they can ask us to find out the discharge through the nozzle and exit velocity. Now here in this problem we need not have to bother what type of nozzle it is. Is what will be given in the problem generally is they will give P1 means the pressure with which the steam enters the nozzle. That pressure will be given. This will be given as so many bar. Then they will give X1, that means the condition of steam when it is entering into the nozzle, what is its condition. Then they will give back pressure or the discharge pressure. Now I will call it as P3. This will be given in bars. Generally it is given in bar. So these things will be given. They can ask if they have given, if they want discharge, they will give you the area at exit in square meters, area at exit in square meters, A3, if they want discharge. Or if they have asked area at exit, they will give the discharge. If area is given, they will ask the discharge. If discharge is given, they will ask the area at exit. Now here what we have to do is, first we have to find out what is the condition of steam at exit, that is X3. We have to find out what is the condition of steam at exit. We have to find out first. Now how do we find it? We will have to find it by using the Mollier chart. Now in this Mollier chart, what is there? This is H, this is S. Now there is a curve like this. This is called the saturation line. Saturation line, it is there. That is X is equal to 1 on this line. It is something like that. Then this area, this region becomes the wet region, and this is the superheated region. So it gets divided. This line divides this graph into two parts. The lower part is the wet part, the upper part is the superheated part. Now in this you will get lines like this, lines running like this. These lines are called constant pressure lines. Constant pressure lines. Now they run across both both wet region as well as superheated region. Then there will be some dotted lines like this. These are called constant volume lines. Constant volume lines. They are also running across both. Then there are some lines like this called constant dryness lines. That is X is equal to 0.95, 0.9, 0.85, like that. This you will find, this constant dryness lines we will find only in wet region. They are not found on superheated region. Here you find these lines, they are called constant temperature lines. Constant temperature lines. So there will be constant pressure lines, constant volume lines, constant temperature lines, and constant dryness lines. So this constant dryness lines will be only in the wet region, constant temperature lines only in the superheated region, whereas constant pressure and constant volume lines will run across both wet as well as superheated region. Now what you have to do here is, first you take this P1, suppose this is P1. This P3 will be always less than P1, that means it will come somewhere here. P3 will come somewhere here. So as you go like this, the pressure increases. As you go like this, the pressure decreases. It is reverse in volume, constant volume. As you come here, the volume decreases. As you go there, the volume increases, in cubic meters per kg. Now take this P1 line. Let us say this is the P1 line. This is the P1 line. If it is superheated here, they will give the condition. It may be superheated, it may be wet, it may be dry. If it is superheated, let us say this is T soup 1 is this. Where this temperature line and where this pressure line is cutting each other. That is the initial condition. The steam is at that condition. Now, they will give P3. P3 will be somewhere here. That line, that pressure line will be here. From here to here, you drop a vertical line. You come vertically downwards. This will be H1. That is the enthalpy in the steam, quantity of steam, quantity of heat in the steam at the initial condition, that is at entrance. Now this is H3, that is the quantity of heat. So it has reduced. This thing remains the same. This is X3. This will be X3, drainage fraction. We don't require it. This H1 and H3 we require. So this steam, whenever it is passing through a nozzle, it loses heat. So H1 is the heat it had at the entrance of nozzle, H3 is the heat it has got at the exit. So the drop of heat is H1 minus H3 will give you the drop in this thing. That drop is converted into velocity. So what is the velocity? Now V3, that is the velocity at exit. How to find out? Now V3 will be equal to root of 2000 into H1 minus H3, that drop, heat drop. So many meters per second. If V1, that is the velocity with which initial velocity, that is the velocity with which the steam enters, that will be 50 meters per second, 60 meters per second, something like that. If that and friction loss, there will be some slight frictional losses. If these are neglected, then this will be the formula. These two are neglected. V1 and frictional loss are neglected. Then this will be the formula for calculating V3. If you consider frictional loss, V3 will be equal to 2000 into H1 minus H3 into 1 minus K. Here K may be 10%, 12%, something like that they may give. If it is given in the problem, then if they say 10% loss is there, then K is 0.1. If they say 15% loss is there, K is 0.15. If they say 12% loss is there, K will be 0.12. That means if there is 15% loss, whatever heat is dropped, 85% of that only is converted into velocity and the other remaining thing is lost due to friction. Next, if only frictional loss is considered and this is neglected. If only this is considered, this is neglected, then V3 will be equal to root of 2000 into H1 minus H3 plus V1 square, under root, whole thing under root. This will be the formula if V1 is considered or that is given in the problem. If they have given it in the problem, that means you have to consider it, otherwise leave it. So like that, if they give both V1 and frictional loss, then it will be a combination of these two. Here 2000 into H1 minus H3 into 1 minus K plus V1 square, whole thing under root. So these are the formula that we will have to use to find out that. Then discharge will be equal to MS, that is mass of steam discharged. This discharge here is always given in kgs, that is mass. So this will be equal to A3 V3 divided by X3 VG3. So many kg per second it is. Kg per second. If they have given the discharge, they will ask A3. If they have given the value of A3, that is the exit area, then this should be in square meters. This you can find out the discharge. If A3 is given, we can find the discharge. If discharge is given, we can find A3 from this equation. So this is on any nozzle. This is one type of problem that can be asked on any one type of problem. Then the second possibility is only a problem on convergent divergent nozzle. They can give a problem only on problem on convergent divergent nozzle. Generally, it is this that is asked. So the nozzle is like this. So here there are three sections. If the steam is flowing like this, this is called the entrance. It is denoted by 1. This is denoted by 2. This is denoted by 3, exit. So this is here P1 will be given, P3 will be given, X1 will be given. Generally, these three are given. Then if they have given A2, they can ask discharge and A3. Or if they have given discharge, they can ask A2 and A3. Or they may simply ask the ratio of A3 by A2. Ratio of A3 to A2 can also be asked that way, if without giving the discharge. So this is given. Now here, the first thing that we have to do is we have to find this P2. This is called throat. This section where the one convergent portion and the divergent portion meet each other, that is called as the throat, or it is the section at which the nozzle has the minimum area or least area. So first we will have to find out P2. In a convergent divergent nozzle, this P2 by P1 is called, this is called as critical pressure ratio. Critical pressure ratio. Why it is called as critical pressure ratio is because here the discharge quantity of the steam flowing through the nozzle depends upon the value of this. So to get maximum discharge, we should have a particular value of P2 by P1, or we should have a value of critical pressure. Now this P2 by P1 should be 0.582 in case of, or if steam is initially means at entrance, if it is wet, P2 by P1 should be equal to 0.577 if steam is initially dry saturated. P2 by P1 must be equal to 0.546 if steam is initially superheated. So which one to be used? You will use only one of them. In one problem, we will use only one. It depends upon what is the given condition here. Whether this steam is wet, dry or superheated. Depending upon that, we have to use one of these three equations. So if we know P1 and we know what is its condition, we can get P2. If it is wet here, P2 will be equal to 0.582 into P1. If it is dry here, P2 will be equal to 0.577 into P1. If it is superheated here, it will be 0.546 into P1. This ratio we are supposed to remember that, this ratio. Then what we have to do after getting P2, we have to find out X2 and X3. First you have to find out P2. Then you have to find out X2 and X3. So now we have to go back again to the Mollier chart. So where is P1? P1 is somewhere here. P2, let us say, is somewhere here. This is P2. This is P3. Now this will be H1. This will be H2. This will be H3. They all come under same straight line. So this is H1, H2, H3. You have to find out these from the tables. H2 and H3 you will get. This will be X2. This will be X3. X3, X2 you will get. So H1, H2, H3 you can get from this thing. Then V2 will be equal to, that is velocity at this point. If you neglect velocity here, and frictional loss, if it is neglected, it will be equal to root of 2000 into H1 minus H2. I have neglected both. Now, it depends whether it is given in the numerical or not. If it is given, we have to consider it. If it is not given, you have to leave it. Now this will give you V2, that is velocity at this point you have to find out. Then V3, that is the exit velocity, that will be equal to, if no losses are there, if there is no frictional loss and initial velocity are not given, then it will be H1 minus H3, so many meters per second. Then what we have to do is, we have to use the formula, discharge formula. Now discharge will be equal to, MS will be equal to A2 V2 by X2 VG2. It is also equal to A3 V3 divided by X3 VG3, so many kg per second. So if discharge is given, they will ask you to find out A2 and A3. If A2 is given, then they will ask discharge and A3, and if they have not given discharge or this thing, they will ask what is the value of A3 by A2. A3 by A2 will be equal to V2 X3 VG3 divided by X2 VG2 into V3 here. By cross multiplication you have to do it. So this is the theory here, and this is how numericals have to be solved. I have given this to you. We will work out numericals in the next video.